Welcome to the tutorials, Contraindications, Warnings, Precautions, and Adverse Effects. So we're going to go over to the documentation page. And you can find it in several areas on our website. In the patient documentation, contraindications, warnings, precautions, and adverse effects. Or contraindications, warnings, precautions, and adverse effects in the physician documents. And also, if you go over to home page and you're going to place an order either as a prepaid or with terms depending on the contract. If you place an email order now, you will find at the bottom if you're a claims examiner or adjuster that you're indicating when you email an order for a claimant that you have viewed and read the contraindications, warnings, and precautions. So we're going to go over that briefly. Now, all information in any format on this site is for informational and educational purposes only. It is not to be taken as medical advice in any manner. Always consult your medical practitioners treating you for medical advice regarding any home medical equipment usage. Please view our disclaimer document and contraindications pages. From time to time, if you have a home therapy program with electrotherapy or traction, because if your medical conditions change over the years, you may end up having a contraindication or a medical condition or personal situation that has changed and now might prohibit you using the equipment that you've been provided. So contraindications, warnings, precautions, and adverse effects. Always read the manual that comes with any medical equipment before using any equipment. Most medical equipment, if not all medical equipment, will come with a manual or other literature which states the various conditions that are either contraindications, warnings, precautions that pertain to that equipment or what adverse effects might result from the use of the equipment. The end user of any equipment must take the initiative and responsibility of reading any and all manuals or materials that come with the equipment and are related to the use of the equipment. So I'm just going to review these. You can pause this, review it at any time. No one should use an electrical stimulation device without a physician prescribing such a unit. A person is required to obtain a prescription or a medical necessity form or physician orders from a licensed physician before use of any electrotherapy device or even traction equipment. Per our understanding, we believe the FDA requires all persons to have a legitimate prescription from a licensed physician if they cannot obtain a portable electrical stimulation device. If you look at the manuals, and you can find our manuals online, it will say on the inside the manual in the beginning parts of every manual that it is on the order of a licensed physician per federal USA law. Okay, electrotherapy should not be utilized on persons with cardiac pacemakers. Now, from time to time, a back surgeon, an orthopedic surgeon, a chronic pain doctor may submit a request, a prescription order for electrotherapy and forget that the person has a cardiac pacemaker. I've had that happen several times over the, I've fit about 3,000 patients over going on more than the last decade, and in almost all cases what we do is we always go to the manufacturer of the pacemaker and say, can your pacemaker, can a person use an electrotherapy device with your pacemaker? And usually the manufacturers say no, but you can always go to the manufacturer. And you also have to go to the physician or physicians treating you for any heart conditions or any type of condition and get their approval too. You always have to go to, because if you're being treated for multiple medical conditions by separate physicians, you should always contact all physicians to see if any form of electrotherapy or medical device should not be recommended based on what those physicians are treating you for. Electrotherapy should not be utilized on persons diagnosed with cancer. Now, there's been a couple cases where somebody has late-term cancer, they're going to die, it's just a matter of time, and they're in pain, and their cancer physician said it was okay to have an electrotherapy device to help them with pain to make them as comfortable as possible until they passed away. So that you have to go to those physicians and find out. The long-term effects of continuing electrical stimulation are unknown. However, they've been in use for about 50 years. Safety has not been determined for electrotherapy use during pregnancy. Do not use electrotherapy if you are pregnant or trying to become pregnant. Precautions should be taken when treating persons with suspected or diagnosed heart disease or cardiac disorders. Again, you have to go to the physicians treating you for those conditions and find out not only from the physician that might have ordered the electrotherapy device, but the actual physicians that are treating you for these other conditions that are not related to your chronic pain or orthopedic injury or soft tissue injury or muscle-related injury. Precautions should be taken when treating persons with suspected or diagnosed epilepsy. Again, you need to talk to the physician that is treating you for that. Do not use electrotherapy directly over the carotid sinus nerves or on persons with known sensitivity to carotid sinus reflux. When using anterior electrode placement over the neck and mouth, severe spasms of the laryngeal and pharyngeal muscles may occur. Contractions may be of a severity to cause difficulty in breathing or close the airway completely. Now, there are times when we mostly deal with workers' comp, orthopedic injuries, but we have, from unlimited basis, provided some electrotherapy for people that have TMJ or jaw pain. So they put the electrodes, you know, on their jaw muscles, and just are careful that they're not putting it around their neck and such, or their throat. Electrotherapy appliances should not be applied transcerebrally. Electrotherapy appliances should not be used to relieve chronic pain until etiology has been established by a licensed physician. Other people might have, you're not supposed to let anybody use your equipment, not a spouse, not a girlfriend, boyfriend, you're just not supposed to let other people use your device, because the purpose or the reason for their pain, if it hasn't been established, then they need to get that checked out. So the equipment is for you and your personal use and not anyone else's. Electrotherapy devices should be kept out of the reach of children. Electrotherapy should not be used when risk of hemorrhage exists. Electrotherapy may disrupt healing of surgically repaired tissue. Now, from time to time, well, on many cases, we provide electrotherapy for people that have knee surgeries, and they use the muscle stims to prevent disuse atrophy and try to maintain some muscle integrity while their surgically repaired ligaments are repaired and ready for some more aggressive rehab. But you have to, what you do, and if you take any of our tutorials, which you should if you get any device from us, is that we always suggest, and even our training tutorials tell you, to put your device on a large muscle group, like say your left thigh or right thigh, that's not injured, and then run through all the cycles, the modes, the parameters. And if you could say the amplitude is from 0 to 50, well, if you can feel current in your, you know, in your large muscle group at 6 or 7 or 8, then you're just going to have to assume that that current is just as strong on your surgically repaired area that you might be treating, because, but you don't feel it because, you know, you're going to have, you might be completely numb for a week or two, or until the numbness from the surgical site where they you know, numbed it to do the surgery, until that completely wears off. You don't want to have your device turned up too much because you can't really feel it because of the numbness lingering, that you end up pulling apart sutures or whatever was surgically attached. So always practice on a non-injured area and get familiar with the various amplitude or power settings so you know it's just as strong on an area that you can't feel because of surgery as it would be on an area that you're practicing on that's good. And always practice on a solid, healthy area of your body to learn about the device and the modes and the functions and the different parameter settings to get familiar with your equipment. Don't practice on the injured area because you don't want to aggravate or inflame anything. Use caution over a menstruating uterus. We don't deal with this very often, but we do sell equipment and supplies to female clinics where their women are battling incontinence issues, and they do use various electrotherapy and electrodes for treating with that. So for any reason that you have electrotherapy for that, you don't use it over a menstruating uterus. Use caution where sensory nerve damage may exist. Usually if you have nerve damage, sometimes physicians prescribe muscle stims with various modes and settings to retrain nerves to fire muscles and maintain muscle integrity, because nerves can take a long time to heal and the muscles can atrophy in that process. And sometimes you just have to retrain the nerves to fire the muscle. But use caution when sensory nerve damage may exist. Do not use around other devices such as EKGs, Holters, heart monitors, etc., because it can affect their readout. Adverse effects. Skin irritation and burns beneath the electrodes have been reported in correlation with the use of electrotherapy. Electrostimulation should only be applied with an effective coupling agent, because that's conductive gel. If skin irritation occurs, determine the cause of irritation, electrodes, tape, or coupling medium, and replace items necessary. Possible allergic reaction to tape or gel can occur. Possible skin irritation or electrode burn under the electrodes can occur. Now, well, that doesn't usually occur very often, but it might occur if your electrodes are drying out, the gel's dried out, and you're not applying conductive gel and conductive tack gel to the electrodes. But we provide you that with our products in your supplies package. So I'm going to close this out, and I'm going to just show you real quick. When you go over into the documentation page, we'll just use a manual here. Say you clicked on the Twin Stim 2 manual, if you had a Twin Stim 2 digital muscle stim tens device. can see caution, important safety information, cautions, warnings, contraindications, adverse reactions. And you'll see that in your manuals. I'm just going to quickly go over to our tent supplies details. We provide supplies that help reduce, that help maintain your skin integrity, because you're putting electrodes on your skin, currents going through your skin, you could be blasting a TENS unit 15 hours a day because you're in really bad pain. That's going to dry out your skin. Dry skin, skin in general impedes current, but dry skin even more. Just think of it as you're walking across the carpet, you kiss your sweetheart, bam, shock yourself in the mouth. Well, current from your mouth bounces off their dry, tight lips, bounces back at you in the mouth, and it stings. So you're going to have to drink a lot of fluids to be hydrated. And then when the electrodes start to dry out, you're going to look at it, and you should take the supplies, tent supplies tutorial. But you can maintain conductive gel capabilities of your electrodes by using the tack gel, conductive tack gel, and the conductive gel by rubbing this around and making sure that your electrodes are fully hydrated and conductive and stick. That way, the transfer of the current from the electrode to your skin will be at optimum. There's two other products that we do supply to try to reduce or avoid any skin irritation. The vitamin E, A, D, E lotion, aloe vera helps keep the skin healthy, hydrated, nourished, and the aloe vera helps reduce any skin burning. It's very minimal at all. But also when you're pulling electrodes on and off, on and off, on and off in the same area, you're pulling on little skin particles and it can get sore. So you can rotate the electrodes. And also we have the pre-tense conductive skin prep, which puts a conductive skin sealant on the skin. You can see, you might be familiar with TENS wipes, but these dry out even before you use them, and basically this is TENS wipes in a bottle with antiperspirant to help the pad stay on. And that puts a conductive skin preparation so that your skin just has a little bit of a barrier that's fully conductive, so when you're pulling your electrodes on and off, it doesn't pull the skin particles. If you have any conditions, any issues, any adverse reactions, if you feel anxiety or you're not even sure if something that's coming up has anything to do with your electrotherapy device or any equipment you have that you've received from any company, including us, always discontinue the use of that equipment effective immediately and contact your medical practitioner to discuss that. It's always best to err on the side of caution. I want to thank you for taking the time to view this tutorial, and I wish you the absolute best success with any home treatment program that you're using.